Now may I request Jabin to talk about CPEC?
Thank you. I will, in my presentation, look at some of the specifics that Professor Raghavan said that we must look at, you know, so using CPEC as a case study. And in fact, this actually means that there's all the more reason why we should be paying close attention to BRI projects in our neighborhood, whether or not we participate in them. And I think in that context, the MEA statement actually of May 13 actually lays out the groundwork for us to direct our efforts on the BRI, on how we should be dealing with BRI projects. So the CPEC is often referred to as a flagship project. That's something the Chinese and the Pakistanis do, but the Pakistanis also call it very frequently a game changer for their economy as well as for their global standing. So the expectations of CPEC are much higher on the Pakistani front. Now what I'm about to present before you, this is all based on Pakistani sources. So if they look strange, if they look normal, well, it's all up to the fact that Pakistan, despite whatever else reputation it might have, has a very thriving media and a very cantankerous intellectual public life as well, which questions both the army as well as their politicians, as well as now increasingly China. GDP numbers, let's just give a few numbers. Pakistan's GDP as of last year is approximately $280 billion. The growth rate as of 2015 was 4.71, which is increased from 2014 of 4.04. And it's expected to hit 5.2% at the end of the 2016-17 financial year, which is at the end of this month. And it's expected that CPEC will add approximately 1.5 to 2% of growth to Pakistan's GDP. And this is 1.52%. These are both figures given by Ehsan Iqbal, who's the Minister of Planning on the Pakistani side in charge of CPEC. So the Pakistanis themselves are multiple figures. Just with respect to China, the trade deficit, you know, is about $6.2 billion, and this Pakistanis are not very happy with this. So this is in the background. Pakistan's forex reserves are just about $20 billion, whereas the debt at the end of the first quarter of 2017 was approximately $75 billion. So, and there has been Pakistani economists who say that this debt will increase to about $110 billion in the next 4 years, vehemently denied by the Pakistani finance minister, Mr. Shattar, of course. Debt servicing itself takes about a quarter of Pakistan's exports. So, which means that Pakistan's external debt is worsening, and a lot of this debt, of course, is tied to the CPEC. However, it's important to also underline the fact that about 35% of Pakistan's import bill is due to oil and gas for its, you know, energy projects. And there, you know, the fact that CPEC energy projects are shifting from oil and gas to coal will have an impact on their import bill. And here I would like you to, I mean, if you've not seen it already, Commander M.S. Rajesh here has written a paper on this particular aspect, the energy aspects of CPEC for the USI Journal. It's available online, it's the latest issue. So I would recommend you to read that paper. In fact, from his paper, I will very quickly quote a few figures on the electricity deficit. Installed capacity in Pakistan is 25 gigawatts, whereas the demand is 17 gigawatts, production is only 12 to 15 gigawatts. So there's a huge deficit there. Price of power per unit is approximately 16-17 rupees, Pakistani rupees per unit, which is double what India gives. So that's just the background in terms of numbers. Now in terms of details, the, you know, $46 billion was the first figure cited for the CPEC. It then went up to 54.5, then 62, and the latest I've seen is $71.5 billion. So there is some serious money at least being topped up, if not actually visible in the in practice. Now, contrary to what might be said about Chinese projects in general, a lot of details about the CPEC are actually available in the public domain in Pakistan. Pakistanis have a couple of official websites to deal with CPEC exclusively, and a multiple array of Twitter handles that put out information very frequently. But and Chinese as well as Pakistani analysts admit, Pakistanis certainly in private and in public, Chinese in private, that there are many aspects that they do not understand the economics of it don't really make much sense. So as far as the economics is concerned, let's come to the first important issue, which I think is employment. Pakistan has a population of 201 million people. The median age is 22.7. So which is to say that half the population is under 22, 23 years of age, which is an increasing number of people entering the labor force every year. Whereas the employment figures that the Chinese, two Chinese figures I've seen so far, the Chinese ambassador last year said about 6,000 people had been employed so far, last year, March of 2016. And 6,000. And Liu Jinsong, who's a DCM here in India, had a speech in Bombay in April, said 13,000 people. So that's, well, if you take those trends, that's not much of a trend. But the Pakistanis quote a figure of 2.32 million jobs. So which trend is quite something else entirely from what the Chinese themselves say. So there is that part. And Ehsan Iqbal has actually said, well, China is going to shift 85 million jobs in the next few years, and Pakistan is in place to get most of those jobs. Actually, Pakistan has to, if it has to create 1 million jobs annually, it has to grow at a rate of 7 to 8% per year. And that is not the growth that it is seeing at the moment, as we just saw. Employment figures are available for all the provinces, including AJK, but not for Gilgit-Baltistan. So we do not know exactly how much is going to be contributed to GB by the CPEC. There are off and on little figures of jobs coming out. Gwalior, for example, the Gwalior representative in the National Assembly says thousands of jobs are going to be created. Whereas the head of the Gwalior Port Authority himself asked the question, how qualified are Balochis for jobs that Gwalior Port will offer? So he basically says no jobs or not enough jobs, not many jobs are going to be created by Gwalior Port. Security seems to be the big sector where jobs are going to be created. Again, several figures, 15,000, 18,000. If that's the kind of figures that are going to be employed in security, which means that there's going to be a fair number of Chinese also going to be employed in Pakistan. But again, to quote Professor Iqbal, and he's a professor by the way, so one imagines he knows his numbers pretty well, but he says only a few thousand Chinese are actually employed in Pakistan at the moment, and he specifically calls them temporary labor. If you look at employment, one wonders where these thousands of Pakistani students on scholarship in China, where are they going to be employed? So just to take two cases, the Saibal power plant in near Lahore has about 190 Pakistani engineers employed. The Port Qasim project near Karachi, another 100 engineers who are just in China at the moment on training. So that's about it. But it's important to keep in mind, to go a little further back and look at the impact of the China-Pakistan FTA signed in 2007. That FTA has actually led to the loss of jobs, the migration of jobs from Pakistan to China. 20,000 jobs have been lost just in the shoe manufacturing sector alone. So not only will CPEC have to create jobs, it'll have to make up for jobs already lost to China. Now let's come to the question of, what is the price or what are the costs of these projects for Pakistan? The Pakistanis and the Chinese are still arguing, negotiating, bargaining about the rates of interest for some of these projects. To take just the case of one CPEC infrastructure projects, China says is being extended to Pakistan at 1.6%. And this covers about $11, $12 billion worth of projects. But the Pakistanis are still arguing for 1%, which is to say that, Pakistanis definitely are not happy with this particular rate of interest. Alongside the Chinese do give a few sops. For example, the Gwalior International Airport is being converted from a loan to a grant. The new road, the Gwalior East Bay Expressway, again, it's an interest-free loan. But in general, we have not enough details about the exact rates of interest. In fact, if you talk about oversight, the Pakistan Parliament's Public Accounts Committee, as late as March of this year, was asking the government, tell us what the rates of interest are. And the government, it does two things. Either it does not send its officials to these meetings, or it says there are no loans. None of these projects are on loans. There have been data. The Sri Lanka case, in fact, is being quoted widely among Pakistani Pakistani economists, saying that are we going down the Sri Lanka path? In fact, it has been pointed out that Chinese banks are actually charging Pakistan higher rates of interest, and this is a data that comes out from the Pakistani Parliament's own data. What is the actual money that China has to, Pakistan has to pay back China? One figure over a, for these loans, for these Chinese investments or loans, call it what you will, is about $90 billion, which is to say about $3 to $4 billion per year in just after 2020, just for debt resurfacing. Of course, the chief economist of the Pakistani government says it'll peak at $5 billion by 2022, and after that, it's going down. But how he reaches those figures, no idea. And he's basically saying that most of these loans will be serviced by transit fees, which is about, and after transit fees or after interest, you'll have about $2 billion in the kitty. I've been not been able to find out exactly how transit fees are being charged and what are the fees, what's the fee structure, and so on. None of the Chinese sources, of course, give us any of this information. And if that were not enough, the Chinese have helped the Pakistanis with a, to try and service other loan repayments. The Pakistanis just paid off $750 million worth of debt in euro bonds because the Chinese gave them $1 billion to repay that. So in just the last 9 months, the Chinese have given an extra $2 billion just to help Pakistan with its debt repayment. And exports are not growing fast enough. In fact, exports actually, depending on where you get your figures from, exports are actually declining. Then in addition, Pakistani Senate, some of these points that our MEA raised in terms of, whether these are sustainable for our countries. I'm not sure whether we were actually worried so much about Pakistan, but the Pakistanis certainly are worried about Pakistan. There is a question of fairness. There are 9 special economic zones that are being set up in Pakistan by the Chinese, but apparently no Pakistani companies are being invited to participate in those SEZs. So that's something actually the Pakistanis are complaining about, plus tax exemptions. In the 2007 FTA, by up to 2015, the Pakistanis had lost approximately $200 million a year because of tax exemptions given to Chinese products. These SEZ companies also, nobody knows exactly how much of it will be, tax exempt, whether Pakistani suppliers will be, exempt from sales tax and so on. So all of those questions remain open. In addition, Balochistan has actually given the entire Gwadar port area land that Balochistan has given to the Pakistani operator, the Chinese operator, is again tax exempt, whereas they paid about $62 million for the entire acquisition. The port authority's revenue, 15% is supposed to go to the Pakistani side, but there is a catch. The Pakistani side is not really allowed to look at the books of the Gwadar Port Authority, of the Chinese operator. So one does not know how exactly they are going to calculate the revenue in order to get their 15%. So this is out there as well. So, I will, end with this line that the Pakistani Senate Planning and Development Committee chair said, China is a brother, but business is business. So if the Pakistanis are going to get to this level, I think, it's something to watch out for. Having said that, the caveat for our side is basically there is a fair degree of consensus on the need for something like CPEC for Pakistan. So the Pakistanis are going to try very, very hard to make it succeed. The Pakistani government, as well as the Pakistani army, as well as I'd imagine a fair amount of Pakistani intellectuals as well. So despite political bickering, there is a fair degree of support for CPEC. So in terms of our approach, to CPEC, I don't think we should be going by worst case scenarios for Pakistan and best case scenarios for India. Thank you.